Fine.
Yeah, keeping it together?
Yeah, more or less.
Sure. Nice bookshelf.
All right, thanks.
Yeah. I've read a few of those books, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Especially those two.
Thank you so much for joining us. And for giving your time to talk to the students. So I just wanted to introduce you quickly to Cesar, who is an old friend of mine and who's running this course. And it was an incredible initiative that he started at Hong Kong University. So it's a course focused on interplanetary species, and he's driving this, he's designed students to kind of to think, with the focus on Mars. So he reached out to us a couple of months ago, basically just asked if we could collaborate as the Mars Society, and also work with some of the ideas that we're developing with our startup on neurotechnology. I'll let Cesar kind of tell you a little bit more about that, but that's kind of why we're here, and the guys have been working on the initial ideas around that. So yeah, we just wanted them to kind of to get your feedback, to show what they've been working on, and yeah, just for you to share your vision for Mars, and specifically focus on kind of human factors and psychology for Martian missions and colonies in the future.
Sure.
So just before we pass it to Cesar to say a couple of words, guys, I've kind of told you who Robert Zubrin is already, but I'll just kind of remind you and repeat. So he's one of the foremost known people on Mars. He's one of the founders of the Mars Society. He's written a lot of great books on Mars. He's worked with, you've definitely worked with NASA. I don't know if you've worked with the European guys. At any point, have you?
I haven't really worked with ESA. I've met with them, I've briefed them, I've had discussions with them, and ESA people have participated in the Mars Society's programs, including sure. Mars Desert and Mars Arctic Research Stations.
Yeah. So yeah, Robert Zubrin, he's awesome to listen to. Lots of great ideas, obviously lots of knowledge and expertise, but yeah, it should be insightful and interesting for you guys to listen to him, hopefully, and hopefully you have some great questions for him.
Okay, so
by the way, thanks for waking up early and making it on time.
It's 7 o'clock here. It's not that early.
So, Cesar, just let you introduce and talk about the course.
Sorry, I'll give you a quick introduction for brief, so you know the context of this conversation. So the brief was designed for multi-planetary. So we assume we're going to Mars. And so the discussion is less how are we going to Mars, but how are we going to get there? How are we going to live there? So we have a partner with Martin and Zara because of their two hats that they are wearing and one of the Mars Society. And also because they are working on a neuroscience technology company that's looking potentially, they have these two interests of like the future of like the human mind and human brain, and also very interested in space. And if you put these two things together, is how would the minds and the bodies of humans would evolve or would adapt to Mars. This is a one semester program, so the students are about halfway. So today what you will see is going to be basically their concepts. And so far they've worked mostly on the conceptual level. So it's not necessarily super technically refined. This is more the idea stage. So they're going to present you concepts. And the next is that based on some of the feedback, maybe some of the pointers that you give to them or remarks, they are going to either completely change direction or they will go deeper into a specific technology that maybe you might be aware of. So this day is particularly important because they're about to have a 3 weeks revision break. So we are following the academic study. So what you will tell them will have a very big influence on them because they will have a long time to think about what you just tell them. So the idea is this, is to help to design the future of humans, minds and bodies as they go to Mars. So it's a hostile environment. how would they adapt or how would they evolve, and what kind of technology would they be wearing or carrying or having the environment. So we really focus on this aspect of design. The students you're going to see are going to be presented in a chronological order. And so we made several assumptions, and you may disagree with certain time scale or technology scale, but we assume that in 2020, there's nobody on Mars, but in, say, in 5 years, there might be 2 or 5 people. In 10 years, there might be 10 to 100 people, and so on and so on. And so the technology, now it's mobile phone or maybe some wearables, we're talking about the technology that will be present in everyday's life. So we're thinking more kind of at the edge of research and market adoption. We don't exactly know when market adoption will happen, but we know that roughly we're going to have technologies which are more integrated into the human bodies, and that's, you know, changing genetic and changing like the way we interface with neurotechnology is also going to evolve very, very fast. And so for each date, there's usually 1 or 2 students per date. And so they present to you a travel in time, and so it's going to get increasingly kind of creative and sci-fi, if you will. Yep. So they're going to present each of them for 1 minute, so which is very fast. They'll present you illustrations or movies, and then about 1 minute or so for feedback. Because we have 15 students, basically, if we can have like quick presentation and quick feedback, and after about half an hour, then we'll have a couple of questions based on some of the research that you have already done and connected to this topic. Is that good for you?
Sure.
Okay, great. So I'm going to pass to the students. So the first presentation, so they're all going to have 1 minute to introduce, is going to be Wendy. So Mars in 2023. So Wendy, or all the students, when you want the next, you just tell me next and I will pass the next slide.
Okay, could you please just jump to the last slide of mine? Yes, this one. Okay. So I can start now.
Yes.
Since the fragrance can be associated with memories and people, and fragrance psychology claims that fragrance can also affect human spirits. So for instance, the lavender incense can relieve humans' anxiety. So mental status also influences on efficiency and concentration and etc. So hence, astronauts can adjust their spirits while smelling different fragrances. The problem is that it's unlikely to bring infinite types of fragrances, and the fragrances will also volatile. So I designed a fragrance molecule 3D printer, like a low resolution prototype, and also in the ear pierce. So the data like the heartbeats and respiratory rates can reflect astronaut's mentality, and then AI can instruct the printer to print the corresponding fragrance molecule. And the atoms are stored according to their types, like the carbon and oxygen and so on, in the glass containers.
Thank you. So you also made some research of like making a more complex interface at the beginning. I think maybe just to mention, but I think then you opted for something much more simple. Yeah. Okay. So what's your impression, Mr. Zubrin, if you imagine astronaut with relaxing earrings?
Was that a question for Wendy or a question for me?
For you. For Mr. Zubrin.
Okay, well, actually, this is the first time I ever heard anyone talk about the smell fragrances, but obviously, the first thing to do is to get rid of bad smells of machinery and such like that, but then to get past simply an antiseptic hospital smell, to be able to have things smell like the great outdoors, might be very good for morale. So these are interesting thoughts.
I read that the smell in the International Space Station is very bad. It smells like a gym. Is that something you've heard as well?
Yeah.
Are there any measures, or does it affect the productivity, or?
Well, I imagine they get used to it. I mean, there are other environments on Earth, like submarines and so forth, that have similar problem, but. If we're going to Mars to settle, we should have an enjoyable environment.
Super quick question. How's the snow in the Mars simulation habitats, like the MDRS, Robert?
It's okay. But you should understand that MDRS does not recycle its air. MDRS uses ambient air. It does have very limited ventilation, it's true. But I've always found the air inside of MDRS and the flash line station in the Arctic to be acceptable. But in a truly confined environment, like the space station or a Mars station, I think this is an issue that would have to be addressed.
Thank you very much. The next student is Fergal. If you can share your video as well. So the students present with the videos.
Do I need to share screen or is it just yours?
Preferably if you can show your face.
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay.
I can see you.
Okay, yeah. Great.
All right, can you jump slide, please? Jump one more, please. Yeah, jump one more. No, yeah, wait, yeah. Yeah, so then the time zone that I have is 2025, and I believe that scientists, astronauts at that time would be trying to find a sustainable way to maintain basic survival, such as like food, water, and like building an infrastructure. So then they can prepare for settlements to come over and like to build like a colony. So then the question that I was thinking about that I can tackle for this project is that, is there a way to accelerate exploration whilst trying to minimize the exploitation of resources on Mars? So then the product that I made is a wearable device that can analyze foreign objects during expeditions on Mars, such as igneous rocks on the surface of Mars or even meteorites that land on Mars, while simultaneously analyzing the body and giving comprehensive information about the user's physical and emotional conditions. So that's my overall idea of my product. Can you jump a slide, Caesar, please? Yeah. So like when they like touch objects on Mars, then the interface will analyze it. And if you can jump one more slide, Caesar, please. And then the information will pop up on the wearable device. And then it will be more effective than bringing items back to like a laboratory and doing experiments there. So that's it.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
So what's your initial reaction?
Well, that'd be a very useful device to have, both for Mars or for Earth. Of course, there's a lot of engineering that would have to be done to make that a reality, but certainly having a suite of sensors inside of a glove that could both sense the outside, i.e., for instance, a rock that you're holding, or the inside, your metabolism, would be a tremendous invention.
What do you think would be a good avenue or resources for looking into the sensors? What do you think would be the closest that there is today?
Well, I don't know. I mean, obviously, right now, most sensors tend to be geared towards particular things. For instance, you could sense iron by magnetic susceptibility. One could sense radioactive materials, of course, by counters. Well, there are things, X-ray fluorescence spectrometers and so forth could test elemental compositions. It would be really a lot of work to try to incorporate all these things. Of course, there are sensors now, biological sensors, they can test your temperature and your blood pressure with a rather limited device that they put on your finger. That could be inside the glove. So in terms of the testing of the metabolism, there are certain things that have already been invented that could be incorporated into it. Oxygen content of the blood can even be tested that way. In terms of the samples on the outside, one would just have to look at it. What are the available sensors that are, you know, lightweight and, you know, chip size that can be incorporated into a glove? And then what are things that would be important to develop that haven't been developed?
Yeah, okay. Just one quick question from me before we go to the next student. Robert, how much do you worry about ionizing radiation's effects on electronics? And kind of what's, do you know what the half-life of electronics is on the rovers, for example? So I imagine a lot of the reason they fail is because of the radiation, right? I mean, it's hard to harden electronics. It's not trivial.
Well, it's not trivial, but it's been dealt with. I mean, look, the Opportunity rover lasted on Mars for 15 years. And even the Viking landers made in the 70s lasted on Mars for more than 4 years. So there is care that has to be done here, but in fact, this is an area that I think we've mastered. The rovers did not fail due to electronics. The rovers eventually failed due to mechanical failures. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. So Matthew, Nomi, if you can come up with your faces. Is it the right slide or are we going forward?
Could you go to the next slide, please?
This one?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, so our concept is basically a brain-computer interface that acquires brain signals and translates them into commands that are then later relayed to control machines, robots, or to test our mental health. So we thought of this device to be a portable or wearable one, as we thought about the technology, how it changes through the past and onto the future. For example, like the computer as the components of the computer compared to today have shrunk dramatically.
Yeah, and next slide, please. Next one. Yeah, this one. This is our prototype. It mainly has two parts. The upper part is used to measure brain signals, and the lower part continues to process the signals as a basis for communication or control. And currently, it is not operable, but it shows how settlers use our device. Yeah, that's all.
Thank you. So what's your first impression?
Well, this is very interesting. It's sort of an electronic telepathy. I understand there are prototypes of such devices that exist. I think one was used by Stephen Hawking to allow him to talk. You'd have to watch what you're thinking. The wrong things can happen, the utility of it is clear. I think this is an interesting field for people to work on. And obviously, if you have transmitters of this kind, you can have receivers. People could talk to each other this way too. But once again, when you speak, you can, in principle, at least control what you say. When you think, it's harder.
Do you think people are going on a really, really critical mission that are investments of billions of dollars? Do you think that the people who commissioned this mission would want to have knowledge of what the agents are thinking, even when they are sleeping, let's say, because they really want to monitor, because those human assets are too valuable? Do you think that's
thinking? Well, maybe, but I wouldn't do it for that reason. That would be intrusive. Actually, what I like this for is to allow a person to monitor a large number of machines. It's hard to pay attention to a large number of machines and all their different sensors and know that there aren't parts in it that are getting too hot and, or too cold, or the flow is too fast, or the voltage is too high, and all these different things. Perhaps if you had a hat like this that was had receivers of all the different health monitoring devices on a large number of systems and could rapidly alert the person who's wearing it to pay attention to a problem as soon as it started to develop, because it's really easy to miss things if you're just, you know, sitting in a control room and looking at all the meters and dials. Or I mean, just imagine in your car, okay, what do you have? You have a speedometer, you have a fuel gauge, maybe you have something that's reading the charge in the battery, engine temperature, but only being read in one location. You know, maybe something that's telling you if your wheels, the tires have enough air, but there are so many other things that are going on in a car. And now you don't want to be paying attention while you're driving to a big control panel with 100 different instrument measurements on it. But if you had something like this that could immediately call your attention to a problem area, you know, then you punch that one up and you see, oh, okay, we've reached, you know, 130 degrees on this particular part. It shouldn't be that hot. Better, you know, adjust something. I think this would be very interesting for monitoring the health and status of systems.
So I'm just wondering if your if your perspective that this won't be used for monitoring humans and how we're doing, whether it's when we're sleeping throughout the day and so on, maybe even tweaking how we're feeling throughout the day to keep us in an optimal range and that sort of thing. I wonder if you think that that's not a positive use case, in part because you're American, you know, and there's a certain, depending on who gets there first.
I'm not just American. I'm very American. And yeah. It would bother me. I think, you know, devices that monitor someone's health, fine. But a device that monitors someone's thoughts, I would oppose that.
Even at the cost of mission or life criticality and sort of, you know, right. Fair enough.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Sorry, can I just jump in with a quick thing? I just wanted to ask Robert. So obviously you know about Mars more than anybody on this call, and it would be great, I think, as you're hearing these presentations, because it's something new for the guys as well, and we kind of trying to support and teach them about the constraints of Mars as well, as they might not be aware of all of them. So if there's something with a specific proposal that really strikes you and you see a very clear constraint there that they might want to address in further development of the proposal, that could be very helpful as well. Thank you.
Okay.
So now we are in Mars in 2033. So now maybe there's like the population of Mars is growing. So we have Oscar and Erica. So Mars 2033.
Yep. Next, like, yeah, keep going next. Yep. Next. Yeah, okay. So for our, because it's year 2033, our theme is invasive design, and basically what we came up with was a device called PRID, which is pain receptor inhibitor device. It's a invasive device that uses transunious electrical nerve stimulation in the brain. So they use floating chips that read or write the brain and inhibit, and through that, controlling it through like radio frequency, it can inhibit pain and act as such like a analgesic, basically. Because it's an extrapolated design. So we assume that there would be a technological advancement in the in this technology to do such a thing. So we're focusing on this design for mostly medical application for like intensive expeditions in the Mars landscape.
To avoid pain, because you expect it would be very physically painful.
Usually, it will probably be injuries, like injuries and yeah.
So if somebody is injured, they have something that's already pre-installed in their costume, and they can have anesthesia, electronic anesthesia. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Well, I think it's interesting for medical application. I would certainly, as a user, want to be able to turn it off so that someone can't inflict pain on me by remote control. But but of course, in medicine, we do anesthesia all the time with injections and things. And if you could do it without that, and of course, it'd be very hard to do that with someone wearing a spacesuit. That would be a very useful thing. And even if the person wasn't wearing a spacesuit, if they were on an operating table inside the habitat, this would eliminate the need to take a lot of anesthetics with you to Mars.
Thank you. Now we are in 2040. So now the colony is, let's say, the size of a village. So it's a bigger population. So I have Tanya and Carson, if you can share your video. And what slide should I go to? Just this one?
So this was Carson's illustration on smart dust, more of like a marketing material instead of an actual prototype.
That's fine.
Yep. Carson, do you want to explain?
So the basic idea of the design is about this technology that's somewhat existing today as of using nanotech technology. So it's very small, like dust. So the initial design now could actually go into different bodies and be having different types of sensors, try to track out what problems the bodies might have. But soon in the future, scientists believe that these devices could be even used as a healing bot. So they would fix the problems before you even know it. This image using plague doctors of the past kind of talks about how maybe if these devices were hacked or illegally controlled somehow, a user might not actually ever have control of his body health. So someone else will be in control of his body, painting a bloodier picture in the dystopian future for this technology.
So can you explain this a little more? What is the smart dust? What does it do?
The smart dust now is still an idea in a way. It is based on some types of technology that some firms are actually making. It's basically a primary nanotech technology that is inserted into your brain. So it would detect what I think all types of sensors. And I think they're making it into having functions sooner or later in the future. So it's very conceptual.
I see. So it's tiny little sensor probes that could be injected into you and could monitor your health all
yep.
over your...
Yep.
I see. Something very like that. Interesting. Yeah. Okay. So
for the development... for the development, we look towards a more healthy and a more hopeful future. So we looked into creating a company that would... have these services secured so you won't be afraid of your health being controlled by someone you don't want to.
Right. Now, these pictures show them as being sort of like nano robots. Is that the idea? That they also
somewhat,
do
yes, but
bodily if, repairs?
Yeah, yeah. If you search smart dust, then I think it'll be more accurate, but there isn't.
So if you search for neural dust, Cesar, if you search for neural dust, yeah. There is a version that MIT and some other guys prototyped. And basically with RF, you can induce currents in these things. You can induce currents with RF frequency from outside of the head. And then they can record and stimulate. That's the idea. They've been tested in sort of in vitro. I don't think there's been in vivo testing yet, but it's, you know, early days.
Okay, very interesting.
Great, I'm just going back to the presentation here. Okay.
By the way, Carson, I think the tricky thing is that once, and I think that's kind of the point that Robert was making, that once you have technology that can modulate your pain, or in this case, other things, right, like more general purpose neural brain modulation, it's really hard to like plan and design ahead of time, kind of beneficial use cases. Like, you know, things can be hacked, things can be used for other purposes. It's really, really hard to...
Okay, so the next group is Yui and Winnie. So we're in 2060, so far further in the future. Which slide should I go to?
Can you start with 52? And 52. Then we'll go back. Yeah.
Okay.
So for our projects, which take place in 2060, we wanted to look at the idea of designing and re-engineering the human body for Mars. And so we looked through the conditions of life on Mars, and we came up with a few potential biological traits that would be desirable to live there. Can you go to the next slide? Then we took a step back and we thought that before we engineer these traits into the human body, we need to test them out somehow. So to see if they're actually useful. So we came up with a few devices to augment the human body on Earth, so that based on the traits that we want humans on Mars to have. And so right now we have two devices that to augment hands and ears. And we're looking into adding one more to enhance our eyes. And Winnie's gonna talk about this one.
So this ear augmentation is a rounded shape with a flipping system. And this device will automatically flip and close to the ears when it detected a high density level of dust. So the inner part of the device has an ear cushion where it sits over the ears, and it could also detect the person's exposure to radiation, including UVA and UVB. So the red strip will light up to warn the user, as well as the case of extreme radiation. So it has a small speaker to give out warnings, and this also provide a real-time translation on Mars, so there are no language barriers.
And the other device is like a six finger, so it can be used for that enhanced motor skills, which would be useful at fixing or doing works on Mars missions. And it also could help us to understand which part of our brains would control extra prosthetics. So it's more also like a research device for biological augmentations. So that's what we have so far.
Okay, very interesting.
Do you think that human bodies will be augmented with accessories, or do you think they'll be biologically augmented? Think it'd be an internal modification, or do you think it'd be an external improvement?
Well, it's much easier to do engineering modifications. For instance, if you want a sixth finger, a second opposable thumb like you have here, it's much easier to imagine just doing it mechanically this way than trying to genetically engineer a person to have such a feature.
Thank you. Now it's the last group, so it's Mars 2100. So now the imagination is that there will be a rather large community of people living in Mars, and the technology will be so advanced that basically, like, we would have merged with technologies, roughly the context. So Bhavisha and Sun, which is the slide I should be going to?
Next. One more. Yes, this one. Our concept is a personal AI friend that is customized for every individual by complementing your personality and daily lifestyle. It will be implemented on you through less invasive, more usable, adaptable technology such as bone conduction, or through fashionable jewelry as wearable technology. this device can be installed at home through 3D printing.
Yes, so for the eyepiece, it is basically a contact lens, which acts as a visual bridge between you and the AI assistant. It helps you to spot stuff, search and navigate and et cetera. And we formulated the brain machine interface like this because different from other groups, we wanted to make the technology less invasive because we know this kind of technology can be uncertain, like their illegal use or something like that. So we focus on not making them invasive and not linked to our neural system that much. And yeah, also the design prevents people around you to oversee or overhear things because it is kind of close to you and only you can see it.
Lastly, social media in that era would be used where users can record and live stream experiences through this technology, where users can subscribe to particular eras and share sensations or relive experiences through the nervous system.
Thank you. Everybody would be equipped with the same device or just a certain class of Mars dwellers?
Are you asking a question to me or to the students?
I was, because you were not asking questions yet, maybe I was trying to get a bit more out of them, maybe to motivate feedback from you or.
Okay, so these are AI devices. For instance, this earring is like a portable, basically intelligence augmentation. It has all sorts of artificial intelligence and knowledge. Is that what it is?
Yeah, so basically that small chip is, we wanted it to act like a device that can hear what you say and kind of speak to you maybe through bone conduction. So it can be very small. And we think that because we are in like 2100 and not at 2100, and then we think like the internet will be so quick. So maybe that chip is only an internet chip, which the program and all the safe stuff is not there, so that the technology can be really, really small. And then it just basically continuously communicating with the mainframe or the computer that may be in your house or in your car or whatever. So yeah, so the idea is making the kind of bone induction or that kind of internet chip very, very small that is nearly invisible and that can be put in your ear.
Yeah, our main goal is efficiency and we want to ingrain this technology as much as possible into everyone's everyday lifestyle, such as giving you recommendations, giving you reminders, tracking your health and data, like incorporating all the technology that must have been developed throughout the upcoming 90 years into the small one device that is in a way your best friend and knows you better than you know yourself.
Well, it's very interesting because, you know, obviously for a long time, there's going to be a great labor shortage on Mars, even when there's 1 million people there or 10 million people there. That's very small compared to the population of the Earth. And so a labor shortage means a shortage, not just of numbers of people, but of diversity of skills. And with something like this, maybe you could greatly multiply the number of skills that a person has, that instead of just knowing how to do a few things, they can know how to do almost everything known to civilization. And that would do a great deal to solve the problem. And so this would be a very valuable invention.
So my worry is actually that anything that's electronics is going to degrade because of the radiation. And so you need to be able to either create them again or recycle them and reuse the materials, right? You can't bring 100 copies per person of each product or of each augmentation. So you have to either build it on Mars or recycle it once it's brought there, right? So that's a big major concern with all of these things, right? Anything electronic will eventually degrade. That this is just, no matter how much hardening you do, there's just not enough protection, radiation protection on Mars.
Well, maybe they need self-repairing electronics. Maybe electronics with some of those nanorobots in them that can patrol them and fix parts of the circuit that have been damaged.
Well,
in fact, that would probably be an easier application for nanorobots than trying to fix human bodies.
Oh, brain, yeah, much, much harder.
I had a question, because we wanted, because by that era, 3D printers would be in every household, and we wanted to have people print their own version, and therefore, like, we're not too sure about the electronics or materials yet, so if they want to replace it, it can just easily be done through printing it really quickly. So do you think, will 3D printing be that advanced by then, or how can we maybe incorporate this into material or electronics?
Well, I think 3D printing will be very advanced by then, and certainly in setting up all the circuitry, and then you could just have a computer put the program in it. Back in the 70s when I was in college, I had a summer job winding cables for dentist chairs, and we would take wires and we take the green wire and go from nail A to nail C to nail F to nail R, and take the blue wire and go from nail B to D to C to G and so forth. And you'd string all these wires up and then you'd make a harness. And it would take 15 minutes to make one. And now these things can just be stamped out as printed circuits, you know, 10 a second. The idea of making whole, essentially, computers with very high capabilities by just 3D printing, you know, 80 years from now, hardly seems fantastical to me.
Yeah. That's a great segue. So overall, like, what's your impression of the students' work? So you feel that it's something that's rather predictable? Do you think that they are thinking far enough, or do you think that they're actually quite...
Well, I think these are very interesting innovations. I think it's interesting that most of them have been about sort of the mind-machine interface in some way or another, it's an interesting approach to things. I have to say, I have talked to American Mars design classes of students, and they tend to focus on engineering devices. So it is interesting that these students have taken a very different approach towards what they've identified as key problems. But I think they're very interesting approaches.
So I think that's a partly a result of the collaboration with us, you know, with Mind, my company, our company with Zera. We're working in this direction of brain-computer interfaces, right, through different approaches, biometrics, EEG, and so on. So I was wondering, like, you know, when you've talked to Americans or American students and engineers, like, how much have you heard about them thinking in this direction of, like, reading the mental state, reading the physiological state, affecting them? Do you see much thought and kind of
ideation? Well, I have seen people interested in health monitoring devices, but but not in terms of mind-computer interfaces, no. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. What do you think that's the case? Because isn't one of the main reasons of mission failure is human error?
I don't think so. Human missions tend to be more resilient than unmanned missions because you have humans on the scene that can correct flawed systems. Of course, the most famous example is Apollo 13. You know, to take an alternative, you know, you take Galileo, mission was extremely impaired because an antenna wouldn't open up. And if that had been a manned mission, people could have gone outside and opened it. So I think that humans are a tremendous resource for improving the reliability of space systems. You know, the Soviet space program, every one of their unmanned Mars probes failed, but the vast majority of their piloted missions to their various space stations succeeded. But I think that the mind-machine interface that you have is a way to greatly improve the ability of humans to correct machinery. For instance, the example of that sensor helmet where someone could be aware of what's going on in hundreds of mechanical and electrical and chemical systems and be able to intervene swiftly before the problem expands. This one here, where you could basically augment someone's intelligence, not in the sense of making them a genius, but in the sense of endowing them with basically every skill that any person has. If you need to know how to fix a certain kind of circuits, all of a sudden you'd be an expert in that. If you need to know how to fix plumbing, all of a sudden you'd know about that. Having people who have skills in every area and who are aware of every problem would greatly improve and expand the value that the human factor brings to the mission.
So, Robert, question. I think bringing humans to Mars adds flexibility, adaptability, and you know, the machines and robots are not at that stage right now, right? And so, with that comes capability for using it towards fixing machines, doing basic science, establishing the first civilization there, and so on. Good things, let's say, broadly speaking. Also with that flexibility and adaptability, you get the possibility of quote unquote bad things, right? I mean, a single bad human actor could destroy a whole settlement easily. And so I guess, the thought there is that maybe you can attenuate some of those tendencies, as creepy and totalitarian a direction as that might go into. You can attenuate some of those tendencies just a little bit or nudge people away from them while preserving and bringing the flexibility, adaptability, and, spirit of humans as opposed to robots.
Say this about that. People will go to Mars if it offers them more freedom. They will not go to Mars if it offers them less. Furthermore, historically, the easiest society for tyrants to oppress are peasant societies in which no single person is essential. You can kill half the village and the other half will just keep going. The individual peasant can cause a certain amount of damage, but he can't damage the system if he decides to be a rebel. In the Middle Ages, there was a saying, city air makes a man free. Now in a city where you have a interconnected population, interdependent, there's much more harm a disaffected individual can cause, and so you have to treat them better. And I believe that a space colony, if you want to prevent disaffected people from causing damage, because yes, one person who wants to destroy could cause a great deal of destruction, is you want to have a form of government that makes everyone earns everyone's loyalty. So that everyone will voluntarily work together to solve all problems rather than to try to create problems.
I I hear you. I think it could go in both directions, right? Augmenting humans, the brain, the body. It could go in a totalitarian direction, more libertarian even direction, right? You could get superhumans that are more drone-like, or you could get superhumans effectively compared to humans today that are much more, you know, individualistic, right? It could very well, I can foresee it going in both directions.
Well, technology is just capability. And capabilities can always be used for good or bad purposes, okay? Airplanes let us fly around the world. They also can be used as bombers. I mean, and this is the case with everything. You know, electricity can be used to give us light. It can be used to electrocute people. You know, radio and television can convey truth or they can convey lies.
Don't you think that so, the nature...
And we're seeing this right now with the internet itself, right? It can be a source for spreading knowledge or a source for spreading lies. But nevertheless, capability is a form of freedom, okay? I think we would all agree that a person who can allow the blind to see is a good person. Even if sometimes perhaps allowing someone to see allows that person to commit murder. You know, any capability, you know, the vision, the gift of sight is a gift, but it can be used for good or evil. Any capability is something that can be used for good or evil, but capability in and of itself is a good.
But it's not equal, right? It's not like the distribution of the potential for good or evil is equal for all types of technology. So I think there is a reason why we don't willingly and actively spread engineering designs of atom bombs to everyone. There's a reason we don't do that. There's a reason we have very careful monitoring of countries, the nuclear stockpiles, the processing, the knowledge of, you know, nuclear engineering. I mean, you know more about this than me. You're a nuclear engineer, I think, by training, right?
Yes.
So you know, there's a reason we don't do that, because some things are more easily abusable, or if they are abused, the risk is far greater than other things. So I guess... The thing I'm getting to is, like, do you feel, and I suspect I know the answer, but do you feel that this sort of technology is potentially rife more for misuse?
I've talked about some potential problems I see with some of these technologies, but also the benefits that they would offer. Yes, you know, nuclear fission can be used to produce electricity, or it can be used to produce bombs. Artificial intelligence can be used to give people every skill to be creative people, or it could be used to give stormtroopers unlimited abilities to tyrannize people. So there's always going to have to be a role for conscience here.
I have a question continuing on this idea. So let's say that the choice is that technology augments people, and that's a very good thing. Do you think that now the race for Mars is has become increasingly powered by corporation rather than countries? Do you think that they would change the form of governance or the form of society that would be formed on Mars if they are formed by corporation rather than by national agencies or international corporations?
Well, it might very well change the initial form of the government on Mars, but the ultimate form the government takes on Mars will be determined by the Martian settlers themselves. Whether they're sent there by governments or corporations, ultimately it will be the people there that will decide what the kind of governments that there be on Mars, the people and also reality, because people can have many different ideas about what kind of government there should be, but these will all be put to the test of success or failure in the situation of Mars. And obviously only those that succeed will persist.
Right. So maybe we have some questions we've prepared which are very directly related to the brief. Maybe it's the first one, and then I'll open to the students. So how should the minds and the bodies of human Martians be improved to live on Mars? What do you think would be necessary or desirable?
Well, I think that having, as I said, a multiplicity of skills, which in part can be done through education, but certainly artificial intelligence is a way of multiplying the number of skills that a person can have. There's that. In terms of bodies, the bodies of humans are somewhat over-designed for Mars. That is, we're stronger than we need to be for Mars because it has lower gravity than Earth. But I think that's a good thing. That will help people do things on Mars. But certainly artificial augmentations or even, telerobots that can be commanded by a human in a suit who can move his fingers, arms, and hands and have the robot do exactly the same thing. And those can be outside doing all sorts of things. That would be a very interesting augmentation to the human to have exterior to him or herself agents that can act in this way on their behalf.
Do you have questions from the students? I can see some of the questions are appearing. So this one is a question from the students.
How would societies on Mars be organized? Well, once again, that's going to be up to the Martians. Now, I have a certain knowledge of current human social thought, and I actually am a supporter of the kind of divided and limited government that we have in the United States. I think it's the best compromise between order and freedom, but I'm not going to make that decision. That decision's going to be made by the Martians. And my guess is there'll be different groups of people that go to Mars who have very different and varying ideas, including new ideas that no one has ever thought of yet, and which many people on Earth today don't like. Typically, people who have new ideas on human social organization are not popular among everyone else. And they're going to want to have a place where they can go, where they can give their ideas a try. And the ideas that really are good ideas will prove themselves in action. And those colonies will succeed, and they will grow, and they'll become examples to everyone else.
Thank you very much. And probably the last question.
Is it ethical to terraform Mars?
So I asked this question, and is it okay if I add some more information to my question?
Sure,
go ahead.
We had a guest speaker a few weeks ago. We had Frank White on, and then he compared going to Mars similar to Columbus going to America, and like how we explore the resources, and that he said that we should find a balance between exploration and also exploitation. And that I read your debate from 2002, where you talked about whether it is ethical to terraform Mars if there is life on Mars. But then because this is already 18 years ago and that a lot of new technological advancements happen, even if there's no life on Mars, do you think that it is still ethical to terraform Mars? Maybe we shouldn't terraform Mars because of the culture there is there, or should we just use Mars as a way to continue our existence as humanity?
Well, I think that comparing terraforming Mars with the displacement of Native Americans is wrong, and is just a huge mistake. In New York City, there is a place called Columbus Circle. In fact, I used to work near there for a number of years. And there's a statue of Christopher Columbus there, and which was put up in 1892, which was on the 400th anniversary of Columbus's discovery of America. And on the sides of it, it says in both Italian and in English, it says, "To the world, he gave a world." And at that time, Columbus was universally honored as the person who had given the world. Now, of course, there were people there before Columbus. There were probably about 3 million Native Americans in North America at the time when Columbus landed. There was also other life. There were 60 million bison. There were vast forests, including giant towering redwood trees and so forth. Now, in consequence of Columbus's voyage and everything that was done afterwards, there's now a nation here of 300 million people, hundreds of cities, universities, used bookstores, continental nation based on liberty that has contributed to human social thought, to literature, invented steamboats, telegraphs, electricity, light bulbs, motion pictures, aeroplanes, electronic computers, nuclear power, the internet, all sorts of things. Now, in consequence of that creation, the world that was there was severely damaged, although there still are about 3 million Native Americans here. Certainly their independent cultures were destroyed. The 60 million bison are down to about 1 million. There are some redwoods, but not vast forests of them. So something was destroyed, something of real value was destroyed, something of great value was created. Now, people debate, was it worth it to create this at the expense of that? And, you know, in the United States, we used to have, still in places do, Columbus Day parades, where they have parades honoring Columbus. But there are also people who turn out with signs protesting those parades, saying that this was wrong, Columbus should not be honored, he was a destroyer. Okay, well, something was created, something was destroyed. And people can argue about whether it was worth it to destroy what was there in order to create what is here now. But if there had been nothing here in America when Columbus landed, no Native American cultures, no vast herds of bison, no towering redwood forests, just a dead desert with maybe some microbes in the groundwater under it, would anybody, and instead we had turned that into this continental nation of liberty with all that it has, would anyone be picketing Columbus Day parades today? I don't think so. And, you know, if I was to go to anyone, whether that person is an environmentalist or an oil company executive, and say to them, you know, I got this great idea. Why don't we take the Earth as it is now, with all these forests and jungles and coral reefs and fishes in the ocean and birds in the air and all these different animals and the cities with people and theaters and all this stuff. And why don't we just get rid of that and turn it into a planet like Mars, where there'd be nothing here at all but a desert with maybe some bacteria underground. What do you think of that idea? They would say, well, that's crazy. You're out of your mind. Okay, you're proposing the most gigantic environmental crime that anyone has ever conceived of, turning a living Earth into a dead or almost completely dead desert. That would be horrible. Well, and I would agree with them on that point. That would be a really bad idea. Okay, well, if that is a truly horrible thing to do, then taking a dead desert Mars and turning it into a wonderful living planet like the Earth must be a wonderful thing to do, okay? Would be the most miraculous and grand thing that people could ever do. And to object to it is simply saying that anything people do is wrong, no matter what it is, okay? Well, if you can make an environment worse, it means you can also make it better. And turning Mars from a dead world into a living world would be the most powerful demonstration of the value of humanity that anyone could conceive of. No one could look at it and not be prouder to be human.
How bad would you feel about the Martian microbes, though, if they're there and we, you know, destroy their environment and they disappear, or they end up?
Well, first of all, number one, the idea that we could wipe out native Martian microbes living in groundwater is absurd. The Earth's original inhabitants were microbes who could not tolerate oxygen. And when photosynthetic plants transformed the atmosphere of the Earth and made it filled with oxygen, the surface of the Earth became uninhabitable for them. And this occurred billions of years ago. And so what did they do? They went underground into the groundwater. And they've been there ever since for 3 billion years. They've, you know, seen the trilobites come and go. They've seen the dinosaurs come and go. Okay, you know, they've seen the mastodons come and go. They've seen the Wehrmacht come and go. Okay, and they will see us come and go. And we couldn't possibly exterminate them. You could terraform Mars and you wouldn't exterminate them. Secondly, because life has terraformed the Earth and not exterminated them. And secondly, though, the more fundamental question is, what is your basic of ethics? Okay, in my view, the basis of ethics has got to be humanism. You know, doctors kill billions of bacteria to cure patients, and we say that is a good thing. Murderers kill people and create food for trillions of bacteria, and we say they are evil, even though they're providing dinners for trillions of bacteria. So what is your criteria for good and evil? And the criteria is what is good for people, not what is good for bacteria.
I think that's a dangerous view. Once we have general purpose AI, if every entity, every species had that as its ethics, right? And once you got general purpose AI and it had that as its ethics, not that human, you know, flourishing is the basis of all that's good, but that its flourishing is the basis of all that's good, you know, it's not going to go well for us. And that's kind of been the history of every species that's taken over or dominated, you know, our planet. So I think a more sustainable, in my humble opinion, more sustainable view is some kind of an ecological view where you say, well, sure, we need to feed ourselves. You can't just not eat. So you're going to eat some plants and you might eat some meat here and there and whatnot. But, you know, you try to preserve other species as well, right?
In the process. Well, you try to preserve. You do your best. Well, slow down. Mm-hmm. Okay. I think we should preserve elephants because a world with elephants is more interesting and good for people than a world without elephants. But I don't think we should try to preserve the coronavirus. I don't think we should try to preserve smallpox, okay? I don't try to preserve polio or malaria, okay? These things we should not try to preserve. So we should try to preserve the rainforest because it has all these interesting plants and animals in it that make this a more interesting and joyous world for people. But we shouldn't try to preserve disease organisms.
I mean, look, I agree. I'm playing a bit of devil's advocate as well. But okay, so some things we should preserve and some things maybe not as much, you're saying.
Yeah, and the criteria should be humanism.
Do we have an agreement on what that means, though? I bet if we actually explore that, we'd agree on a lot of the major points and we disagree on a lot of fine details.
Yeah, sure.
Isn't that a problem? Because okay. You're going to get different people.
Well, I think Mars, there right? needs to be, a general human consensus on that, because some people might say, well, clearing the rainforest provides more farmland. And it does. But you can say, well, we don't need more farmland because we can increase the productivity of the farmland we have through advancing agricultural technology. And we want to preserve the rainforest. And it's a question of balance. You know, when settlers came to North America, there was no farmland here. Farmland does not exist in nature. All fertile land is spoken for by wild plants. To create farmland, you have to clear them and plow and in some cases irrigate and do all sorts of things that change the environment. Now, a certain amount of that wild land had to be cleared, but once we had enough of it, then, and this happened in the late 1800s, people started saying, well, we've destroyed a great number of forests, but we still have some left. Let's create national parks. And, you know, a third of the United States is essentially undeveloped. Because a balance was struck. Now you could say maybe it should have been half, maybe it should have been three quarters. There is a balance. But once again, why did we preserve the forests in our national parks? It was for the benefit of people.
My next question is, you have been talking to a lot of people and people ask you a lot of questions. I think you've been doing this for many years. Do you see an evolution in the minds of young people, the kind of question they ask and the kind of ideas they have? And do you think that's the way young people, the young generation is changing, is in the direction that'd be more conducive to be successful to colonize Mars?
Well, in some ways, yes. In some ways, no. I think there is a general sense that that's much more prevalent now, that a positive human future involves human expansion to space. Also, just among young people, there are far more girls interested in such things than there used to be. Far more, and in science in general. And I think that's a very positive development. I think one negative development is that there's an increasing number of people, including absolutely young people, who are less interested in doing and experiencing things themselves instead of just virtually. And we're seeing this, for instance, in the increase in the number of obese people, including obese young people, compared to even 30 years ago. I mean, it's quite significant. It's more than doubled in the United States and in Europe. And kids don't play sports as much. They sit at home in front of computers or video games or you know, things. And so I think that that's a problem. So once again, there is an example where, okay, a technology can be both a good and a bad thing. But overall, I think it's better. As I say, the expansion of interest in science and technology and engineering from just boys to boys and girls is an enormous positive development. I don't think we would succeed in becoming a spacefaring civilization if it's just a boys' game. That's a very important thing. I think that in terms of some of these other problems, it's something that people will come to understand and get under control. That, you know, it's like video games or Twitter are kind of like a drug. It's causing a lot of addiction right now, but I think people will come to understand that it has to be taken in moderation. It's like when you bring alcohol to a culture that has never had it before, it can cause tremendous damage. Or candy. But eventually people learn how to cope with these things and use them to the extent they are useful.
Maybe that's my last question, unless other people have a closing question, is what gives you the most hope for the future?
Kids like these.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Robert. Enjoy chatting. Right. Thanks for making time.
All right, my pleasure. Okay.
Bye. Thank you very much, Robert.
Thank you. Bye. Bye-bye. Bye.
Cool, that was fun. What'd you guys think?
So now we're gonna interview you guys.
What's that?
We're going to interview all the students. So we flip it and right. We're going to interview the students.
Sounds good.
What's your impression of Mr. Zubrin? Do you think he's a visionary? Or do you think he has many, many ideas? Do you think he's very down to earth? Do you think he's very imaginative? What was your impression of the kind of feedback that he gave you?
I think he has some mindset of different from our such that generation, and yeah, have some different ideas. Yeah.
What was different?
I think it's kind of last generation's idea about some like the video games and such subcultures for the youngsters nowadays.
Mm-hmm. So how different do you think you are from his description? You don't feel that you're addicted to Twitter or this kind of thing that he mentioned, right? Or do you feel so? What do you feel that you disagree most with?
I think it's inevitable that the world is digitalized, and in the future, humans may incorporate the virtual world and the reality.
Sorry, did you say it's inevitable?
I said it's. I mean, there's a tendency. Mm-hmm.
I guess we kind of decide to some extent how we steer towards what kind of future we steer, right? I mean, that's what you guys are hopefully going to do, right? You're gonna help in designing the future a little bit. So you get to decide in what direction it goes. And maybe that's a very addictive future where you're like addicted to tech or tech is controlling you. And maybe it's one where tech is there for giving you more freedom, individual freedom or something. Like I guess that's up for grabs, right? Which part, I'm curious, Wendy, which part do you think is generational? Because this is a very common sentiment that younger people, I think, tend to say that, you know, our generation is different. The older generation doesn't get it, but it's a common sentiment, right? And I think in more ways than not, we tend to be the same as the last generation in our behaviors. After all, we're only human, right?
Yeah.
I want to challenge you on that, actually. Like, I don't know, like, yes, it's true, but at the same time, like, do you really, every time you heard, like when you were younger and you had kind of your parents telling you things, yeah, some things you're like, oh, okay, like I should have known better. But there's definitely, in my opinion, a generational change that, you know, I think different generations just don't necessarily get. And I think I quite enjoyed actually listening to him because he seemed, I got a very similar impression, and it's quite different. I thought it was great that you guys got to experience him, and then like two weeks ago you had Frank White, and they're, you know, very different, and clearly he disagrees with some of Frank's sentiments. And I thought that was really great for you guys to kind of just get to see that. And yeah, I think there's that space in between that, like, for really, you know, novel things to come out from every new generation that I think like past generations block on, and they kind of almost look down in a sense, like, well, we kind of know better. I think they do, but I think there's definitely something with each new generation comes out that new, that older ones, they just don't, like, they can't really understand because they don't have that experience that you guys are going through now. Anyways, that was a bit of a disagreement, I guess, with that.
I also have something I want to add.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, I was just thinking about Martin's question, and I think maybe something that's generational is that I think for people from my generation, we were born into like a very digital, I guess, experience. Like we were very, like, we raised up like with internet, and kids these days have like phones when they were like 5 or 6. So it's a very different experience from a lot of other people had, that it's like growing up in like a childhood in the outdoors. But also something that really caught my attention when I heard Dr. Zubrin said, was talking, is that technology at the end is capability. And I think it ties a bit with what you were saying, is that you can use it for good or bad. And at the end of the day, it's like how you decide and how you choose to use it for the future. Yeah, that's it.
One of the parts that I liked the most was when I was asked, I think when you were asking him, Martin, as well, like when we were talking about like, would people give up? Would it be acceptable for having like constant line monitoring? And it was very interesting to me that he's very against it. And he's saying it's very, very American to be against like mind control. And I think it's super interesting because in China now, with the social credit system and like constant face tracking of people when you work in public space, or if you live in a place like Singapore, you know, it's just matter of fact, like you are here, you get all these benefits, and the cost of it is your freedom. And I think those societies, in a way, they have gone forward very, very fast because they have accepted to make this compromise. And so in my mind, a Chinese astronaut, they wouldn't even be asked the question whether they would be willing to share their biological data. They would just be matter of fact, and they would just consider this to be granted. If you want to be part of this mission and you want me to invest billions on taking the risk of putting you, I'm not going to even ask you the question. Of course, I'm going to be monitoring even your dreams because I want to know, you know, how. And so in my mind, like, you know, there's a great empires. They have a certain set of ethics. Let's say the Roman Empire, like a certain set of ethics, and you have like the French ideology of the Lumière, the Enlightenment, Renaissance. Like every age had its kind of leader because they had their own set of ethics, But it's quite clear now that you know, China, India, those countries that have very different cultural background are really taking off and potentially, you know, little by little taking over, and they have very different set of ethics, And so I think, you know, the idea that the American set of ethics will prevail in new colonies, I think it's going to be a short-lived truth. Maybe it will be true for a certain amount of time because America is still extremely strong. But I think when those other countries take over, then these other sets of culture norms will prevail. It's my opinion.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, quite possibly, right? I don't know. And I think like part of it is up to like the adaptability of these political systems. And I think that's going to show, especially at a place like Mars, right? It's going to show whether which one is kind of more adaptable, which one is kind of, what's the word I'm looking for? Like a more stable, yeah, maybe adaptable. Maybe that's the right word, like more adaptable for the Martian environment, right? I mean, it's possible that something much more controlled and, you know, controlled, I guess, kind of might end up being the way to go. And maybe not. I don't know. We'll find out, I guess. There's a really good series, guys, by the way, from National Geographic called Mars. It's a mixture of documentary and a sci-fi series. I think there's three seasons. It's really, really good. Zubrin's in it. He's one of the characters. So it's kind of based in the current time, and then it jumps to the future, like 30 years in the future, I think. So highly recommend you guys watching that, because actually a lot of it is about these different ideologies and how they play out on Mars.
I would like to share.
It'll come down to power as well, I think, right? So it's like whatever you have different countries that are launching, and you know, you have such a difference with, say, like, you know, China, where, you know, they accept that monitoring and that's just a matter of fact. And if they manage to, like, I think, grow and succeed, and, you know, it'll kind of all come down to efficiency and economics. And if those colonies are more powerful in the end, like, I think that's kind of where the competition will kind of dictate as well. So I think that some of the technology will, it's a bit like competition in business, right? Like you adopt a new technology and now legal firms, right? So they're all starting to use AI. Well, not all. So initially, like, you're like, never, you know, it's very old school traditional industry where, you know, no way, how can robot replace us? And then one firm, you know, starts using a technology AI assistant, and you know, gradually all others will have to use it, because otherwise they're going to be left behind, because these guys are doing it much better, much more efficient, they get more business. And I think it will be like something similar to this. Because the human factor and like enablement is just such a part, like it's such a powerful tool.
I just wanted to share really briefly this video. What I was mentioning, that, you know, America is going to be out of the picture by 2100, is, so this is the human population in 2010. And so now you have like mega cities or big cities in every continent. I mean, you don't have in Australia, Oceania, but if you go in 2025, then you already have no more mega cities, or the Europe is out of the picture. In 2025, the top 30th biggest city, none of them are gonna be in Europe. If you go then in 2050, most of the bigger cities are going to be basically in Asia, Manila, Tokyo, Mumbai. So that's the future. And in 2075, actually China is out of the picture. None of the world's biggest city would be in China by 2075, because the population of India and Africa would have grown so much. And in the US, there would be no more Europe. There would be only New York City and Mexico City. And then if you go to 2100, even there's no more China, no more America, no more Latin America, only Africa and India in terms of population. And so I think we tend to forget that, because now we think like America is so powerful, but in like, yeah, in 8 years from now, it would be like what we think today, say of Italy or Poland. They're like really nice country, cultural center. They are very interesting, but they won't be. It's not where the action is going to be. For most, these are just like statistics or demographics. So it doesn't represent everything, but still, like when you see that kind of map, I think it tells you, I mean, this is just like where the people are going to be.
Yeah, but Cesar, you have Mexico City, which is, how many people are in Mexico City? Like 20 million?
20 million now. It's about
20 million. Yeah, and I mean, a lot of people might want to live there, and that's fine. But I think the quality of life for most people in Mexico City is not comparable to most people in Tokyo, for example.
Yes, that's true.
Right? Yeah, so the fact that there's a lot of people doesn't necessarily mean that people will thrive there or want to live there even.
Right.
Like from abroad, right? That it's going to be a cultural.
Yeah, totally.
This
is just a single indicator. I totally agree. Like the quality of life and the level of education, access to yeah, for sure. But also those cities will improve, I'm sure. You know, like Mexico City.
Oh, yeah.
Improve, yeah. Sure. Yeah. Other students, like some of the feedback, were you surprised by some of the feedback that you got? Or did you expect it? Like which feedback did you get, most surprised by? Is there a way to get people of this caliber? So I think we should take the time to reflect on the feedback that we've got. Did some of the things that he said you feel that made you change your mind about what you want to do or change slightly your direction or make some adjustments?
I think for us it was hard to envision our concepts, but then like seeing someone who's like been working since like the 80s or the 90s and how he can believe in our ideas, like how he explained like the cable wiring concept to us, I feel like it made me realize that it's more feasible than I originally thought, and that I shouldn't just limit myself to what I've just been growing up with.
Right. I think that's true for a lot of what he said to you, is that he's just like, oh yeah, absolutely, we're going to do that. I think for a lot of what you guys presented, he believed in it because he's seen this happen in research. So I hope that gives you also some confidence that what you're doing, what we're doing right now, is not purely sci-fi. We're using sci-fi as a format to kind of facilitate the creative process. But what you do, you could actually get jobs in industry, you know, pushing this kind of agenda. So the things that you're designing now, it may sound crazy, but that's my job as a teacher and Zara and Martin to actually, show you like, yeah, these industries are emerging. These are real jobs. And you are part of the few people that actually are thinking in those kind of dimension. So you will have an advantage if you take this brief seriously and push it all the way to design something that is of quality, because these are real future things that we are designing. I'm very happy that you have this feeling.
I just wanted to add to that, guys. I was telling Martin the other day after our last call, after Frank's call as well. And I was just saying that you guys are so, so lucky, like that you have a tutor that that has this experience of the world and has this vision of the world and has just put this brief for you. Because, I mean, most of the tutors, even, you know, in the college where I studied and that they're teaching now, they don't think like that. And this is a very, like, they're very good tutors. They think creatively. But this is, to me, is like a combination of, you know, like the creativity, the inventiveness, and also like the real world at its best with the kind of insight into the future. And yeah, I just feel really, really like you're very lucky, guys, because this is happening, is the future. And you're one of the very few people out there at this stage that are actually thinking about it and having the opportunity to really get insights. I mean, the stuff that Martin and I are working on, a lot of the people, you know, in the AI industry have no idea about BCI. I'm sure even Robert, as well educated he is in the space of Mars, he doesn't, you know, necessarily know as much about brain computer interfaces, just because it's a very niche field. And Martin is like one of the like few world experts working at the intersection of brain and AI. So yeah, just make the most of it. And I'm sure like 10 years down the line, when you look back, you'll remember.
Thank you, very, very kind, sir.
Cool, well, thanks guys. Hope you had fun. See you next time.
Thank you. So I'll stay with them. We're going to see them. You will see them, I think, in a month, basically, because there's three sessions without you. So I'll keep working with them because we'll have another 25 minutes with them. But if you guys want to go, you can go. I'll keep working with them to prepare them for this long journey in isolation.
Guys, good luck. Stay alive. Have fun. Thanks,
and well done on all the prototypes and narrowing, simplifying your pitch. That was really good, like very clear. Yeah, it was a big progression from the first time you presented. So really well done and good luck.
Cheers, guys. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Hey, so we have another 25 minutes. We don't have to fill it up necessarily just for the sake of filling it up. But what I wanted to do is to have a very honest conversation with you about the reality of the schedule. So today we are the 7th. So it's this very, very important session that we've had today with Mr. Zubrin. So you're gonna have 3 weeks during which I cannot make the course mandatory because there's a revision time and you might have some exams. So I think it's also important that you have some time to prepare for this. I would like to basically, maybe what I'm thinking is to break out into small groups, not the groups that you have right now, but break out into small groups so that you can actually brainstorm of what you're gonna be doing until the June 15th. So for example, what I can tell you what I'm gonna do is that now I have a better idea of what you're gonna be producing. Of course, you can change your mind and produce something very different. But what I can tell you is that my focus will be on the exhibition production. So I'm gonna be reaching out to the Space Museum, I'm gonna be reaching out to the Space Science Department in HKU, I'm gonna reach out to a bunch of people. And my focus will be on trying to produce a really great show so that by the end of the year, you get to present your work to people like Zubrin, like people who understand the space, who can give you encouragements, but also good criticism, and maybe even people are in the industry, maybe they have some job opportunities. So people who would be relevant to the type of work that you've prepared. So that's going to be my focus, for example, personally. I can tell you. So what I'd like you to do is to break out into small rooms of two. And I'd like for just for 5 minutes, I'd like you to think about how you intend to plan your work. And as you plan your work, what I'd like you to do is this. So I'm preparing a slide. For example, I'm going to ask, say, Yui and Wendy, because you guys show up in that order, for example, to join on this slide, and then to make a plan maybe in your group, because you have groups, right? So maybe we work by groups, you'll be maybe more productive. So two by two, except for Wendy and Fergal, who are singleton, to group by two, and then to discuss what is your plan of attack. So now you have another 6 session, so 6 weeks. What is your plan of attack so that you could deliver something of great value? Sounds good. So I'm going to create those breakouts. Breakout rooms. And I'm going to be creating 9 breakouts. Okay. And so I see you in 5 minutes. So please create a slide like this per team. So we have 9. So you can write your name on it. And then we'll catch up in 5 minutes. Okay, I need to put you guys into the rooms. So can you guys help me? So so the first room, maybe I'll just go by the slides. It might be easier and faster than to ask you verbally. Okay, so the first room with two people is gonna be Matthew and Nomi. Okay. I'm just gonna, where is Nomi? So I'm just gonna change Matthew and Nomi, okay. Then the second room is gonna be Oscar, where is Oscar? Oscar and Erica. Erica, where is Erica? Erica, okay. Then we will have Tanya and Carson. Tanya. So I move to room number 5, Tanya and Carson, and then Yui and Winnie. Yui UE, okay, sorry about this. And then Anson and Bavisha. Move to room number 8. Anson. Move to room number 8. Okay, cool. So Fergal. Actually, I'm going to put Fergal and Wendy into the same room, even though you don't work together anymore. Because you work in the same time zone, I think it'd still be helpful so that you also have somebody to discuss with. So Fergal and Wendy.
Do you think we can take any breaks today? Like a quick 2-minute break?
Okay, you want to take a break now? Please go ahead. Yeah, please take a break. And when you come back, we'll go into the breakouts. So now it's 22:41. We meet at 22:45. Sounds good?
Or maybe we can get into the breakout rooms and have the break included with the timing.
Okay, sounds good. So like this,
more effective. Yeah.
We can go in all the rooms and then let's say that we meet at 22:50. So at least we have more time actually. We will give like 3 minutes of break and then 5 minutes of break of breakout. Sorry. So I see quite a few of you haven't completed their schedule. So maybe I'll clarify. So maybe let me clarify that. Where are the controls? Oh, here, okay. So I'm gonna share my screen. Okay, so what I prepared for each of you. Okay, so I can see some of you are working, that's good. So so I see, for example, Fergal here. He's filling the table. And so the idea is exactly that, is correct, is that you want to, you basically want to kind of plan your work. I don't want to intrude on your process, but I think it's going to be helpful for yourself to clarify what you're going to be doing. So of course, there's going to be a lot of things that are going to change and so on. But I think it is very important that you, that you put some milestones. and that's going to help you for your own production, if you will. You don't need to create new blocks every time. You can actually just type in the table. So for example, you could write directly like this. That would save you some time, and then it's easier to typeset. So let's do another 5 minutes. I'm not expecting that this is going to be final, but I'd like you to all, start to draft more clearly what you're going to be doing. Okay. So I'm going to start the room again. So we talk again in 5 minutes. Hey, welcome back. Okay, so what I'd like to do now is just to go around and then clarify with the other people, including your teammates, how you intend to improve significantly. I'm sharing my screen. Okay, here I am. To significantly increase the quality or the ability of, to communicate your work. So let's go with Fergal. So first with Wendy. So Wendy, right now you have this earring. How are you going to communicate your idea? How are you going to do that?
You mean communicate my plan?
Your concept, yes. So imagine you're going to have a spot in an exhibition somewhere, either at HKU or in a museum or in a gallery. How are you going to communicate? How are you going to communicate your concept?
Oh, my thing is, for me, it's more feasible to edit a video.
Okay, so you're going to make a video of yourself putting an earring. What is this video going to have? Like, how is it going to communicate your idea?
I think I will edit like a real product that presents from the problem that I'm going to address, and then also some examples that existing technology, and then perform the situation that when the astronaut pretending that I'm an astronaut, I encounter a situation that suddenly I feel very stressed, and then the earring function and reflect my heart rate, and then release some fragrance, and then I can show my facial expression change. Yeah, that can present my product effects. Yeah, something like this.
And so that means that you're going to be putting yourself in an environment that looks like a Martian habitat, like when you film, and you're going to be the main the character. Will you change the lighting? Will you change the accessories? How are you going to make people feel that this is Mars?
I can change the video background.
Oh, I see. Okay. Cool. So, and I see that you have office hours. So what I will do is that for the next sessions, I will create office hours during this period. So like this, during the 3 weeks, May 14, 21, 28. Even if we don't have class, I'll have office hours. So you'll be at the same time as we have normally the class. So you'll be able to join me. Maybe a little bit later.
Okay.
Yeah. Great. Thank you. Fergal, what's your strategy for getting your work to be
My strategy is to look into sensors and also medical supplies, because after talking to our guest lecturer about it today, I think that that's the way to go. And that although he said that some of the technologies might not even exist yet, but then I might try and look for like very simple alternatives, such as like the handheld blood pressure thing. So like I'll have a look at those ones, and then I will try and make a more improved prototype that have like these functionalities, and I will and I aim to present that during the exhibition. So then I laid out my timetable, so then it has like, so I have enough time to create the prototype and to test it out.
So for you in particular, so you was mentioning, you know, some of those sensors are very big, etc. But for example, these samples that I have, I have many samples. These are radioactive dusts from the seafloor from Fukushima area, from Fukushima, from the nuclear power plant. And I have bags and bags of those samples. I keep them in my office if I'm not like ingesting them, is they're not dangerous. And I have numbers of they're in my stuff here. But I have radioactivity sensor. And I also have a spectrometer, what he was mentioning, spectrometer. This is a spectrometer that I built myself. You can actually make sensors for very cheap. I can send you some research and some commercial product which are very, very small. So you can actually make a couple of the sensors that you mentioned. It's possible to make simplified version. There's a very small version of this which fits on the lens of your mobile phone. And it's tiny. It's just size of a, it's smaller than this. And it's a spectrometer that you can attach to your mobile phone. So with a mobile phone, you could actually put up a lot of things if you wanted to. Now, I just want to mention to you and to Wendy, because I think you have the same kind of direction. It's great that you learn science and technology, but in this case, it's okay to fake it. What I'm saying is that I think it would be more productive for you to make a video that displays on your phone and then find a way to strap your phone on your wrists and then pretend that all this is happening rather than making it really happen. So same for 1D, like instead of trying to measure human body signals, it is great that you learn about it enough to understand how it works, but because your time is limited, and you need to make sure that you keep enough time to also fake it, to create the experience of, rather than actually do the science under it. Because at the end of the day, it's about communicating it for you within this time. If you're making a PhD about it, of course, I expect that you're going to make a real device. But at this stage, I would expect that you make mostly something to represent the idea. It's theater. It's like cinema. Do you see what I mean?
Yes.
Okay. And I really like, Fergal, that you're taking one way of buffer for the portfolio and exhibition, because you will need it. I think all of you will need that. It means that you will need some time to edit the movies and put it together. I don't think you're going to finish your prototype on the last day. Plan to make your prototype a week ahead, and then you're probably going to spend another week, you know, working really, really hard, because things always take more time than your ambition, especially when you are inexperienced. Matthew and Nomi.
Cesar, I have a question.
Yes.
Because I need to go back home before June, so how can I make a physical prototype and show it on the exhibition? Do I need it?
SF Express. You can send it by post.
Oh, okay. I understand.
And then we can work with the other student to help you display your work. So even if you're not there in person, we can work it out.
Okay. Or so, do you think we can make our 3D model instead?
It's possible, but that means that all that will be seen is basically just a screen or prints. But actually, I think your prototyping is very, very well underway. Out of everybody, I think you build the most physical stuff. So. I was very excited to see your prototype. I think it's super, super exciting. I think you should continue to prototype like this. You're actually on a very, very good direction. I would say keep going, prototype.
And deliver it here.
I think it looks great. I think if you,
okay,
with this concept, now you have the idea of the overall shape. Now you can choose your components more carefully. And then you can make something that is very beautiful and interesting. So I would actually encourage you to continue, if anything. I think it's a very interesting what you're making. It's very clear because your object is so, it's beautiful, it's interesting.
Thank you. And we also think about, do you need to make it work, to actually work?
I really don't think so, because again, because of the time that we have, it's more about talking about the experience. I think making this work would be very, very difficult if you had a neuroscience student in your team and, you know, some budget, of course. But I think the way you're approaching it right now, like a hacker approach, you know, like sticking things on existing garments, that's the way to go. If anything, I think in the class right now you are the kind of example to follow. So keep going.
Thank you.
So are you going to show this device in a Earth environment, or are you going to pretend that you are, because the idea of the story at the beginning was really to help you to create a narration. So are you going to be telling the story, or are you just going to show the object?
I think we will do the both. Because I think we are still working on our story and change something. So maybe we will show both the context and our object.
Yeah, the idea of the story is helps you to present the object. If you find that it's not true in somebody else's case, so not your case, but anybody in the class, if you feel that the story is making it more difficult to explain your object, you can abandon the story. All the process of making the story was to help you to generate the idea. Okay, thank you. Oscar and Erica. So now you have a mask with a sort of circuit. What is this circuit? Is it effectively a paint suppressor?
It's kind of a prop, actually.
Yes, that's fine.
Yeah.
What does it do? Just out of curiosity, I'm just curious.
It's actually it's like a sound system.
Okay.
And it makes like it just makes music. Yeah.
Okay, cool. So what's your plan? What do you hope to present?
I think we need to spend most of our time trying to figure out how do we represent like invasive design through prototyping. Like throughout like the course, I found it quite difficult how to like represent this. So we have to figure out how to do that first. Yeah.
So because of the story can give you a short way in. So for example, like when talking about invasive, that means that at some point there was an invasion, right? That means at some point that thing was inserted in the person or it was placed inside of the person. So what I'm saying is that maybe part of your explanation could be a part where you actually show that device is being implanted in the person.
Okay.
So that can be part of your story. So a scene can be the scene of the implantation, and then another scene is the scene of, you know, recovery or just using the device. Or it could be the opposite. It could be that you are acting normally and nobody knows that there's something, and it's the removal of the implant, and that kind of like reveals, unravels the story. Like, why was this person acting so weird? Well, it's because he's got a chip in his brain. So if you find it difficult to tell because it's not visible from the outside, then you need to, then the story is going to be your way into explaining that. The first one, to do the implant and then show the deviant behavior, I think is the most easy one, but it's not surprising. But having somebody behave weirdly, having somebody behave weirdly and then have the thing removed, that's kind of freaky. So in terms of like storytelling, these are very, very different. One is there's a strong reveal at the end. The other one is just like, oh, we are making a human, versus like, wow, this person is really strange. Oh my god.
I mean, like invasive design in terms of like just like the inserts. It's not really about change of like weird behavior, because it's more, we're trying to focus the product more on like a medical application. So yeah.
So yeah. The thing is, it implanted in the spine.
It's implanted in the brain, and it's like basically stimulus for the nerves and like inhibits pain. That's essentially what the product is.
So I have an uncle who is a laparoscopy expert. Have you ever heard about laparoscopy?
Think so.
So laparoscopy is a type of surgery where you implant...
Fixing, they don't really open you up.
Exactly. So instead of opening you up, they basically make small hole, and then they have those long instruments where they can go and do really complicated stuff within you. So this uncle is making good money, but it's very gross, the kind of work they have to do. But actually, there's a surprising amount of visuals online of laparoscopy, because it's one of these disciplines that requires intensive training.
The bile duct is isolated, ligated and divided.
But what I'm saying is that you could actually take fragments of these kind of videos of like surgery, because there's a lot of this kind of material. It's super gross and super weird, but you could actually use existing footage, and that's true for everybody in the team. So for example, if you have a surgery where they reorganize your organs, they can actually just completely reconfigure your intestine or whatever. It's pretty impressive.
Then our product's more about like just relieving pain for like injuries, I guess, not really like.
It's kind of like an emergency medicine kind of.
Yeah, basically, yeah.
Okay. So it's like at the scene, it's like, it's something that if you're in, for example, like you have like an expedition group and there's like, like an accident, then like the average person would be able to like switch on the device.
And relieve the pain of like the injury caused in the expedition.
Mm-hmm. So I would look into like the like cinematography of how that is done, because there's a lot of you know, it's almost a genre like of this kind of medical intervention. There's so much that is done, so you probably want to look into that, like what is the expression, what are the scenarios. For example, like you see, I have a big scar on my forehead, right? You probably, I don't know if you guys have noticed, I have a big scar on my forehead. And that's because I had a brain surgery when I was a kid, and I was in a very ghetto hospital, and they didn't have surgery, they didn't have anesthetic. So I was brain operated without anesthetic, because I was only four. I was like fighting the doctors. So the reaction to anesthesia or lack of anesthesia can be super different depending on the context. Anyway, so I think you want to look into like people's reaction and how it should be filmed. Like how do you tell that story? Smart Dust, Tanya, and Carson. So what you guys gonna do?
Talk first, Tanya.
No, I think we're just gonna basically try and explain Smart Dust in a quite infographic friendly way by using illustrations and just breaking down the concept, since I feel like some people still don't quite understand. And I think we're also gonna try and put it into perspective with the current pandemic as well.
Yeah, I think, you know, today you just showed an illustration that you produced like 2 weeks before, so I think you really want to, you know,
actually we have a new illustration. So the one I put on right now is new. It's a photograph of dust next to the Da Vinci thing, but dissected, so it makes it more of like a futuristic company. We just don't think there's any possibility of us prototyping this nanotech, so I think our focus would be on explaining how this might work.
Yeah, that's fair. But I think even this new illustration that you have made, if you show it to somebody without an explanation, I would be very surprised if anybody at all could understand what your technology is about.
Oh, there is text next to it, but I can't fit the text along with this image on this slide.
What I'm saying is that your image doesn't tell a story at this stage.
Yeah.
Would you agree with that?
Like, yeah, we'll try to improve that.
So your final product, you think is just going to be a kind of, because I'm not saying that your illustration is bad. I think it's beautiful. It's got its own poetic quality and like aesthetic, and that's great. So what would be the final outcome? Would it just be like a really like a nice fancy illustration, or would it be illustration plus like a novel? What do you think is going to be the final product?
I think probably in the form of an infographic, but I feel like we need to discuss this a bit more, because there can be that creative element, like a book, as you said. But I guess what we wanted to do was just to kind of put it into more perspective, like given that it's like healthcare related, I just find that it's very relevant to right now situations. I feel like we would want to make use of that as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think we would like illustrate it the best.
And anything that's related to like isolation and like disease that are mysterious, I think we could get a lot of attention. So if you publicize it, I think it might get a lot of attention, even if it's sci-fi. People will be like, wow, you know, like Black Mirrors, this kind of like that grabs your attention and imagination.
Yeah.
So you say infographics, do you think like one image, or do you think it's going to be an infographics as in like several image that tell a story, or what do you mean by infographics? So just a diagram that explains the technology of it. What do you mean by infographics?
I think it would be more, I mean, like the creative approach can still be discussed, but I think generally what we're going to do is just try and utilize images and I guess paint a picture of what this technology is. So yes, like infographics that kind of tell a story, but not actually like a poetic story.
So whichever is the way that you want to go, what I strongly suggest to your team is that you want to test your designs and your story on people that don't know anything about the brief. They don't know anything about your technology, and you just submit to them. And then you just ask them you just want to see, do they understand what this is about? Because I think in the whole class, I think your group presentation was the least clear. I think we see it, it's beautiful, it looks good. But just like, he was the only one, he basically stopped and say, so what does this powder do? I think everybody else was quite clear. Yours is the furthest away from clarity in terms of meaning of story. So there's the most work to do. Thank you. Okay, Yui and Winnie, so what are you going to present in the end and how are you going to get there?
So for us, I think we're going to try and make it like a physical thing. We're not going to go into, I think, like you said, we don't have time to do like specific stuff. So we're not going to do like sensing a lot. It's more just like making it like actually mechanically work, like for it to contract or the ears to close. I think that's our main approach, and just trying to make it look good. And yeah,
that's good. In terms of aesthetics, do you want to go towards something that's very robotic, or do you want something that's more biological and it looks like it could almost be like part of the human body? Do you want to kind of integrate, or do you want to add?
So that's what I think we're not sure yet. So that's what I think we have the 3 weeks from the 21st to the 24th. So I think we're going to go through it. Few different aesthetics to see what works for us. Yeah, so I think that's what we're designing then.
There's one artist that you absolutely need to look. His name is Stellark. Stellark is STELLARC, Stellark. He's an Australian artist, a media artist, and he actually grew himself a third ear, and he actually built himself like several there's this very bizarre Stellark. He built himself really really weird stuff. He actually implanted himself an ear on his arm. That's an actual ear that he implanted. It's not functional in the sense that he cannot hear with it, but he's been wearing an ear on his arm for many years. He's doing all sorts of really crazy stuff. Like, he's one of the guys doing suspension. There's no special effect. Like, he actually hooks his skin and suspends himself doing that. He built like an extra arm that actually functions. And so this line of work is actually, he's been doing this in like the 80s and 90s. So this is a real work that he's been doing. This is one of the favorite pieces that he's done that I'd like you to watch, is that not only he made the work, but he used it. And I think that makes a huge, huge difference. So if you are making a third finger, that's great. But if you demonstrate, even if it doesn't fully work, or even if it's working as a fake, for example, like somebody else is actually this extra limb, but if you demonstrate it, it adds an element that is very, very interesting and powerful. Or if you fake it, means that you do it with a special effects, or even with an illustration, I think that would be very, very powerful. So yeah, please check his work. You will find, like, if you search like body art, you will find there's a bunch of other people doing this kind of work. A lot of people are doing like tattoos and stuff like that, but that's not really experimental. There's a lot more experimental work being done. I could find some of those some of the reference for you as well. Okay. Thank you. And then Bhavishan Anson. So what's your plan? What do you want to present and how are you going to get there? Bhavisha? Anson? Are you both here but not here? I can see both of you are not showing your video, so we don't know if we are there. Bhavisha? Anson? Bhavisha? Anson? Okay, so maybe they are no longer here. Okay, so in the interest of time, we're going to close the session today. Oh, yeah. Oh, please go ahead. Hello?
I had internet for a bit. So, hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Please go ahead.
Sorry, I had really bad internet. So, we now want to look more into 3D printing and how we can make our technology and solutions more accessible to everyone, because our conveniency and accessibility is one of our main goals. So, I'll be focusing more on the earring and bone conduction piece, and Anson will be focusing more on about contact lenses. And since we're not really, we want to explore like technology in the future and kind of how individuality, especially since everything's automated. So we want to also look more into fashion, such as maybe colored contact lenses. And we'll be later on making prototype. And in terms of our tangible product, we're thinking of marketing materials such as videos, so that because I feel like that can really appeal to the masses. And then maybe we can we're not sure about like maybe we could, for jewelry it's easier to make, or we can focus more on branding as an element for our final product.
Yeah, I think your video on top, you know, this kind of overlay. Now there are many plugins, for example, on After Effects, they allow you to say take a video from somewhere and then overlay and have like anchor points. So even if the video is moving, actually your overlay really can follow the real world, and that can look super realistic, and that can look really, really great. I think I share with you Hyper Reality, this film by Kenichi Matsuda. Hyper Reality, Kenichi Matsuda. So there's a Hyper Reality. He's a friend of mine. He made this movie. It's quite a long time ago, but I think it's still super, and it's, I think it will remain relevant for a long time. And it's all made in After Effects. It's basically, I showed you this, right? Do you guys remember that?
Yeah, you did, yeah.
Okay, so I think that's an interesting reference for you. For the earpiece, I think it's super easy to 3D print it and just stick it into your ear. So I would argue that your project, you can make a promo video that looks really real, and I could see that looking very, very good. I think it's a great approach to think of promotional material because it's believable technology.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's a very good direction. And sticking something inside of your ear is also easy. So I would encourage you, instead of doing this in 3D, which is not as convincing, it's great for presentation, that's fine. But because it's something that's easy to make in reality, then I encourage you to do it for real. It will be super realistic because it will be real.
Mm-hmm. And we could also maybe, like in a sense, DIY jewelry, but then make new styles so it matches 80 years later.
Exactly. Yeah, that's right. And for this kind of landscape, I have some friends who've been actually building this kind of architecture in Mexico. They've been building those buildings out of pressed dirt. I wish I could find it for you, some of the projects they've made of rammed earth. They've made this rammed earth house. Is it this one? They have made this condominium. I can't see it. But would you know where to find those kind of image? So this kind of round, so these are called round earth wall. So that's the technique, I think, that you find the image. And it's quite popular. There are some really beautiful houses made of that. So you don't have to necessarily create those environments. There are some videos of walkthrough of such houses. So it's the same, like you could also you could also hack basically existing online content. I hope that I could find, but I'm sure you'll find like a really nice house is made of this technique. Okay, do you have any questions? So you're gonna have 3 weeks. I will announce my office hours, which will basically be the same hours as we have generally teaching. Do you have any questions for the weeks that are to come? Or do you have any feedback about today? How was it? Did you enjoy the presentation or? Any question, any feedback, any comments?
I know it's like hi, I just wanted to ask about the lessons we have during the revision period, because I think some of us have exams and stuff to do, so I don't think all of us can make it.
No, I'm not asking you to come. This is optional. Okay. Yeah, it's optional. So the office hours will be just like one-to-one, or if you want to join as a team. It's absolutely non-mandatory. So you can join if you feel that you have some question, if you want to have more advice. The next mandatory session is week number 4.
I was also wondering about the lessons we have after the exam period, because I don't see any other courses having a lesson. So I thought, are we still learning stuff afterwards, or what is it? What's going on afterwards?
So yeah, so there will be classes, and then we will be there to teach you classes. I think at the beginning of this course, I think we went back and forth 3 or 4 times, like adjusting the dates. I confirmed with you the final dates for the presentation. So so we'll still be holding classes. I think hopefully what would happen is that it seems that there's less and less pandemics, less and less virus transmission happening in Hong Kong. And maybe, I hope that by June 4, that the school will be reopened, and that you'll be able to use the workshop if you want to. I hope that the school will be reopened by then. I'm not saying that it will be, I can't control any of that. But what I'm saying is that more and more in Hong Kong, at least, is business as usual, more and more. So it's possible that you would have access again to the school.
I have one thing to add. Yesterday, I tried to enter our studio, but I can't enter.
So I would suggest, before you try to come back, to send a quick message to Anthony, who is on this chat, but you can speak to him personally, just to make sure that your access has been resumed, just so that you're not stuck at the door, just to be sure. That's his job as an administrator to ensure that this kind of like logistics is functioning. So please notify Anthony that you tried and it's not working, because I think that's very precious information for him and for all of us. So please, within this group, ideally, you can tag Anthony and say, at Anthony, hey, I tried to come in the classes today and it was not working. Are we allowed to come back to the studio, or ask a question that you would want to know, or changes that you would want to see happen?
Yeah, because I think now it's for other one to use.
Yeah, I haven't read everything that was sent. I know that there's one studio on the upper floor that's open for a limited number of students to come in. I don't know if all of you can come back, or maybe it's on demand. I'm not entirely sure. We'll have to check. Any other question? Okay, thank you very much. I really enjoyed this session. Sorry for going over time, but I wanted to make sure that before we go apart for a long, long time, I wanted to make sure that you have a good brief, that you have a good feedback, and that you have also a plan for what you're going to be doing for those 3 weeks of self-directed autonomous work. Of course, I'll be there to support you. You can always reach out to me. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.